kept reminding the players, you know, not to let Robertson have a sight of the goal, because if he does, it's normally lands him in the back of your net.
He's probably the best finisher I've ever played with, and I was fortunate to play with Kenny Dalglish, Joe Jordan, Derek Johnson, people of that quality.
Chances on for Robertson, he must score! What a milestone! Command the 3-0,
he just need to knock the ball up into the sort of danger area, and as I said, he can be quiet for 89 minutes, but that minute he's in the park, and the minute he's not before that, he's liable to stick the ball in the back of the net.
Robertson helps it on, there's Robertson!
He's lazy, he's a lazy player, but I think that goes for him because of 20 minutes when you're running about and you're struggling a wee bit because you've put it in early doors. Robbo's a wee bit quicker than you because he's trying to walk the route for the whole game.
John Robertson to break the loading record. Robertson, shot, goal! A tight castle goes wild. John Robertson has broken the all-time league goal scoring record of Jimmy Wardhaugh.
Last season, John Robertson became the greatest striker ever to play for Heart of Midlothian when he broke the record held for 41 years by Jambo legend Jimmy Wardhaugh of 208 league goals.
It's a great goal by John Robertson! He's not only broke the record, he's smashed it!
John has been a loyal servant to Heart for 17 years. However, the story could have been very different.
I'd been training at Easter Road Monday, Tuesday, Thursday for 3 years. Under Jimmy Root, funnily enough, John Fraser, Stan Vincent, and they offered me signing terms, and when my father had died, I decided I was going to Edinburgh, so it was down to Hearts or Hibs. And Hearts, to their credit, they all said, look, we know there's other teams interested in for us, just give us a phone and we'll sort something out. But I went down to Easter Road, and Tom Hart, the chairman, was there with Eddie Turnbull and Jimmy Rourke, and, you know, he found out my brother Chris was playing for Rangers at the time, and then kind of panicked a bit and says, no, well, you either sign now or you don't sign for Hibs again. And we'd done the deal, we'd agreed the terms. I just wanted to run it past Chris to make sure that everything was okay and that he felt that it was right. And Tom Hart wouldn't have this. He says, no, you either sign now or you never wear a Hibs strip again. And so I decided at that time that obviously if that was the attitude that the chairman was taking, that I wouldn't sign.
When John was only 14, his father died. He naturally turned to his older brother Chris for advice, and he was instrumental in bringing John to Hearts.
I was actually here at the time with Hearts seasons, and John had a chance to go to one or two clubs down south, and Hibs were also interested in him. I was a Hearts fan, and I knew John wasn't a bad player, so I kind of encouraged him to come on to the Hearts, and eventually took my place. And I didn't have any career after that with the Hearts. I'm only kidding that.
Once I became professional at 16, it was a wee bit rivalry because Chris made my life hell for 2 years being the ground staff boy. I had to clean his boots, I had to wash his kit, I had to go for his lunch, and I would come back with Chris's lunch and John Brough would send me up for his lunch. I'd come back with John's lunch and Walter Kidby would be waiting to send me up again, and they made my life hell at the time, but to be fair, they did look after me.
John has a remarkable goal record against Hibs. In the early years, his performance may have been spurred on by his rejection at the hands of the Easter Road side.
John Cahoon now with the corner. They've been charging in. There's a chance! John Robertson!
I think it did in the early years. I don't think there's any doubt about that, that I went out there with the attitude that I'm going to show them what they've missed, and the annoyance. Perhaps wanting to sign for them, and not quite a feeling of rejection. Probably it was maybe a letdown in the end. And I thought, well, right, okay, this is it. I'm going to go out there and show what you could have had.
We'll be right back.
ball through to Foster. He's got Robertson in the middle. Good Robertson! What a goal by Hart! Oh, that was magnificent play.
It's a bit too when I went in the first game, but being realistic, I think I can remember when I was maybe about 10, 11, and he was banging the goals in every week. And obviously, he was a hero of mine, and a few of the boys who used to go to the game with, but what I can always remember him with is when he's scoring against Tibbs, and he always seemed to score against them. And I think he gave myself, my family and friends a lot of good pleasure every time he scored against them.
Myself and Alec McDonald were basically at Hearts when he first started to come into the first team, and we played a certain way. He was very fortunate in his early career to play with some very good experienced strikers. Jimmy Bone helped him immensely, and then Sandy Clark, and he developed through that. And I think the Hearts have helped him to actually develop as a player by using big strikers that can maybe take some of the pressure off him and basically use John to the best of his ability.
I've played alongside a lot of good players, scored goals alongside a lot of them. I think the most successful partnership was undoubtedly with Sandy Clark and John Cahoon. The three of us really gelled superbly. John Cahoon's pace and ability to score goals as well from the wing. Sandy Clark's physical presence and again his ability to score goals. I led with myself with the goal sniffing. It was quite a lethal partnership at that time and took us very close to winning the league title in 86. In fairness, I've also had good partnerships with Derek O'Connor, Jimmy Bone. Two similar types of players, very aggressive, good touch as well, and good finishers. There's Scott Crabb, who's very similar to myself, very skillful player, great finisher, terrific free kick expert as well. And probably the one guy who I really have liked to have stayed at the club and kept going is probably for the fact that he's more my kind of protege more than anything else. He'd come through the ranks and I'd passed on a lot to him and I'd liked him to stay, but I've just kept going. At the end of the day, that's what I'm there for. I've been the mainstay scoring the goals and I've managed to fit in with a few partners and they all deserve their place alongside as well because I need their strengths as much as they need mine. And that's the most important thing, is to understand your strike partners, his strong points and his weak points and work hard together. And over the years, I've done that with a few.
Early Pinecastle have already been well documented and his insatiable appetite for goals led to fans and players alike asking if he could become one of the Hearts' all-time greats. The process began in season 89-90 when he broke Alfie Conn's record of 121 league goals. The legendary Willie Bockert of 183 league goals had stood for over 30 years. And most importantly, Jimmy Wardhaugh had scored an incredible 206 league goals in the 1940s and 50s. It was the record that everyone at the club wanted John to break. However, records were forgotten in season 1995 when poor performances in the league meant that the Tynecastle men faced the prospect of a relegation playoff in the last game of the season, one of the most important matches in John's career.
But we had to win the match to avoid playoffs, and I scored the penalty. Nothing too unique about it, it was just a straightforward penalty, but the significance of it was that the club didn't have to go into the relegation playoffs. That would rank alongside possibly the two goals I scored at Dumbarton, which helped the club come up into promotion. They are the important ones. You don't want to be involved staying down in the first division. You don't want to go down into the first division. And although there was, you know, they weren't great goals, they were very, very important for the sake of the club.
The league record that season meant there would have to be changes, and Tommy McLean left Tynecastle to be replaced by the former Hearts captain, Jim Jeffries.
Jim Jeffries brought a sense of Hearts back to Hearts. You know, there's no doubt in the past he was a captain and a long-serving player for 9, 10, 11 years. And he brought back a real sense of spirit into the club again that hadn't been lacking in previous years, but we'd sort of gone away from the Hearts traditional side of things. We'd brought in different managers, tried different things, and we learned a lot, and each one of them was successful in their own way. But I think what Jim Jeffries brought back was a sense of being. He's been associated with the club for so many years. The fans could associate with him. A lot of the fans had seen him play as a player, and he wanted to instill that kind of pride, you know, a real sense of pride in the club and in the players.
There's been much speculation regarding the relationship between John and his manager, but as a professional, Jim Jeffries recognises the importance of John to his squad.
He's been here a long time and you know, he's gained great experience. He's played under a few managers and as I say, you can't take his record away from fantastic goal scoring achievement. And you know, he works away and he gives a wee bit of advice here, there and that's invaluable to any club. For me, you know, he's going to finish chances and he knows that I like to more attacking style. I like to be well organised, but at the same time I like the place to go and express and play football and go at teams and create chances. And if we do that, hopefully John Robertson will benefit as well as the team, because he's the one that can certainly finish them.
A slight one there as he's trying to find Grant. Johnson steps in perhaps. Now it's Miller looking for Robertson. It's away by Gary Smith. Only as far as Mackay. This is Johnson. Aberdeen players all round, only gets it through towards Robertson. It's off the post, it's Robertson! John Robertson makes it 2-0 to Hearts. And that's Hearts' 60th Premier League goal against Aberdeen. It's John Robertson's Premier League goal against Aberdeen. And the Don's defence all over the place, the pass back to the goalkeeper to come off him, off the post, and there was Robertson to finish off. Hearts 2, Aberdeen 0.
When I was in the under-21 team, John had just came in and we had a really good batch of strikers at the time with Nicholas, Eric Black, Morris Johnson, and they were all round about, you know, at the time, and we were having finishing practice, and I can always remember it was with Jock Steen, and I can always remember Jock Steen telling me that John Robertson was the best finisher out of the lot then, you know, and I can always, that's something that's always stuck with me. And I don't know if it's just been his you know, his closeness to the ground, but he's got terrific timing. And you're always known with John Robertson, if it's a challenge, the tremendous strike of the ball, and it's very rarely does he miss a target.
Bett looking for Hagen. Well, Hagen has it now from McLaren's headed clearance. That's good play from Mackay. Robertson's onside. There's Robertson! 1-0 for Hearts! Nine minutes of the first half. Jubilation again for the Hearts supporters. And John Robertson's 13th goal of the season. Appeals there for offside. He was online perhaps with McLaren. But this is top class finishing. Well, Hagen took a poor headed clearance from McLaren. This is an excellent bit of play from Gary Mackay. Superbly shuffling inside. Robertson timed that superbly. He was definitely onside. And the finish, Maxwell, helpless.
I think on a percentage of chances that John gets, it must be a high percentage that he does score with. I was in the Hearts side, so I can say this. There wasn't a lot of chances created, but if there was maybe two or three created, basically always Robin, we got one, two. He was, as I say, he's an excellent finisher. He's a good reader, definitely a good reader of the game. And he is, for his size, he's quite sharp. that's what, where obviously John has made his mark in the penalty box. He doesn't need a lot of room to pull the trigger. And as I say, he does it quite well and he's a good striker of the ball, so anything from 18 yards in normally hits the back of the net.
I don't think he scored many goals against me. Touchwood. No, he was always tricky. I don't think John was ever one of the strikers that would ever run away from you. But when you're in the penalty box, there's not that much space, as you know. And in the 6 yard box, there's even less space. I think to be a good striker nowadays, you've got to sort of play over the shoulder of good defenders and sort of just wait for chances to happen. But I mean, you've got to sort of in between that sort of offside and not offside position, where you're going to get there first for any sort of knockdowns from the goalkeeper or mistakes from the defenders. And John's done that for a number of years now, and it's a big good lesson for any young strikers coming through to watch the way John plays.
Well, that pass goes astray, and that's a mistake for Celtic, being pursued by Bett, who recovers well. Levine, Tosh McKinley.
It's Thomas. Play on, says the referee. It's Gary Mackay. Thomas is still on the ground. It's laid off now to Tosh McKinley. Jumbet drives it through. Robertson. Set beyond Marshall. 42 minutes gone and Hearts take the lead. Jumbet having the Aberdeen and John Robertson was there to get the ball behind Gordon Marshall. Well, John Robertson has a tremendous scoring record against Celtic. It was Jumbet driving it through and Robertson with the touch, wrong-footing the goalkeeper. And what a record this man has against Celtic. He's the top scorer in this fixture and that's his 14th goal against Celtic.
A crucial part of any club is the team spirit. John is fortunate in that at Tynecastle, the atmosphere has always been close between the squad, regardless of the individual's playing experience.
We've always prided ourselves on having a real family atmosphere. Alan McDonald really instilled that. He wanted the players together, he wanted the players socialising together, he wanted the families in and around them. Jim Jeffries is the same, he wants everybody involved, he wants to keep things going, and he wants older players mixing with the young players and passing them bits. There's always pranks going on, there's always wind-ups going on, somebody's always taking a stick in the dressing room, the jokers are always there. I mean, we've got Pinky and Perky at the moment, Jim Hamilton and Neil McCann, and it's an absolute nightmare. You don't know what they're up to 1 minute for the next. They're up to all the tricks in the world, and they think they're the only two that know them. They forget that some of the players there have actually forgotten more of the tricks than they'll ever know.
These are the two jokers of the pack, Mr. Hamilton, Mr. McCann. Quiet as a mouse.
Very quiet.
Mind you, after the performances of late, very, very quiet, the boys. But Neil McCann is going to be the next £1 million player from Hearts. Jim Hamilton, he's either a £2 million...
He's going to be drinking and driving.
Jim Hamilton, to coin a phrase from Tony Fitzpatrick, is either a £2 million player or a £2 player.
Right,
and I still get excited. The game, come to games, you still get butterflies in the tummy. There's no doubt about that. I've been doing it for 17 years, I don't know anyone else, and sometimes you dread it. Obviously there's going to be a day when I have to leave Tynecastle. But as soon as you get into the dressing room amongst the lads, and the banter starts, etc., that just disappears. You get a job. It's the greatest job in the world as far as I'm concerned. Too. Here we go, into the new Tynecastle. You're just going to walk right into a car then. We're going to get a wee treat here. One of the young lads happens to be a very good dancer. Can we clear the floor, please?
Despite being what is today classed as a senior player, John still has a very good relationship with the less experienced squad members.
Right, I'm just going to put him to the highest test here. Let's go, my
game.
This is what happens here. We get the only guy. This is an initiation test for young Mikey.
Get yourself in there. Yourself, name.
I'm Michael Cameron. I'm just going to give you a little song. It's 911 body shaking.
Let's go, boys.
One, two. You've got my body shaking, sends a shiver to my soul. I didn't get no warning. Got me shaking to the bone. I've got my secret weapon. I'm gonna get you all alone. Yeah, yeah. So let your body lose control. Bolt of lightning, could it hit me harder? Yeah, yeah. So let your body lose control.
Thank you, would you, boys? This is our ground staff, lads.
Jonah?
I'm actually supposed to be working, but as usual, as in every club in the world, lazy.
We've finished.
And the boot's done?
Aye.
Good, that's where we're going next, Chrissy boy. What? She's there. Well done, Mikey boy.
Yeah,
well.
Thank you.
Gary Locke, club captain. Club captain, youngest captain ever, 21-year-old, hopeless. And you need an actual foreign language for this man. You can understand the French, the German, the Italians, if you can understand Bonnie.
Connect, what's this for?
You're going for a survivor. It's radio for you, Pop. I just make sure that you're alright.
Legend! Big on the high B's. Guaranteed a goal.
As you can see, the young boys have not all the different pegs here. These are my little ones here. Joke, these should be around the car mirrors because they're so small. But as you can see, they come in various sizes and makes and stuff.
obviously you've got to do your duties as ground staff, and I was on the boots for about a week, but the worst job I got landed with, because I was a bit cheeky when I was younger, I got put in the washing, which is next door, but we've got past it now. The young boys these days, as you can see, easy job, they do. Not like the good old days.
It's been different class with myself, and I think any other young lads at the club would tell you that if you do need advice, Robbo was always there, him and Gary Mackay especially, because they were, like ourselves, they were local lads who came up through the youth ranks, and obviously they had players to look up to when they were younger, and any time that we've had any problems or we feel that we needed advice with them, they were the two that you would go and see. They were always first to sit you down and have a good chat with you for half an hour, so and the two of them have been great with the likes of myself and Big Paul and Alan, and now it's Gary Naismith and players like that.
One legacy of being such a prolific scorer is being labelled a penalty box player. Professionals recognise that he has a lot more to offer the game.
Yeah, he's not just a penalty box player. I think over the years he's been known to link up well with the fellow strikers and midfielders, and he's certainly been one to create a lot of chances as well. But I think people recognise him as a penalty box player because of the number of goals he has scored throughout his career. But there's plenty of other parts to his game other than scoring goals.
Oh, he's awkward, as I say, just for his sheer size. He backs in well, and he does hold the ball up well.
Robbo is very, very skillful. People might not give him credit for that, but having seen him in games, his touches are great, and he can beat men just as we dip his shoulder. And I think he's up there with the best at holding players off. I don't know whether that's just his size or what. I don't know, run the waist, but he's very, very good at holding.
And Robertson was there just ahead of Goff, and he managed to hold off the Rangers skipper and just touch the ball into the path of Neil McCann.
He isn't just a penalty box player. He can join people up, he can take the ball in. As I say, very good football brain, and he can spread the play, and he can make goals as well. But his biggest strength is inside that box. When you're in management or you're playing with him, that's where you want him to be.
In 1995, John's value in important games was proven yet again when Hearts, led out by his two sons, met Hibs at Easter Road. The previous month, John had equaled Willie Ball's league record of 183 league goals. If Hibs won, they would take second place in the Premier League, but John was again determined to spoil their party.
Look at Logan, our sprint coach, seems to think that the bigger the crowd, the better I react. It may well be true. I mean, he winds me up all the time, and unless there's more than 10,000 in the stadium, then I'm not going to go out and play. But I think the reason I've done so well in the big matches is I've tried to, or I feel more relaxed in them, especially the derby games. There's no big secret. I go relaxed, and derby games tend to be tense and tight, and there's a lot of mistakes made. So if you can stay relaxed and wait for the mistakes to come along, then more often than not, you're going to get a chance. And that's all I've done. I've just, work hard, wait for your chances, and when they come along, take them.
This is Robertson trying to get the better of Hunter. He's been clearly held back there. The referee's allowing advantage. Hearts are getting players forward. This is Lawrence. Twisting and turning, trying to find the opening, and flipping that one over the top. Just under 5 minutes of the first half left. Still no scoring. Here come Hearts. It's Robertson clipping it across. McPherson's there! And David McPherson scores for Hearts! Well, David McPherson looking at the far post and picking his spot beyond Jim Leighton. Well, John Robertson, who's always such a thorn, this Hibs side providing the cross, and David McPherson not picked up
picking his spot.
Great play delivered by John Robertson. He's worked today. Not going to get much service into his feet. He's worked ever so hard. And he puts a great cross for Big Dave McPherson, who again has been playing particularly well. But Robertson, a thorn in the hip side.
Keith Wright does well under pressure. McGinley sends that one through. It's Gareth Evans. And then comes the substitute. And Graham Donald scores the equaliser for Hibernian.
In the 60th minute, Hearts received a further blow. They were reduced to 10 men when Gary Mackay was sent off, and worse was to come.
Played into the near post. It's away by Love. Hamilton's there to return it. It's Love again for Hibs. And it way down the Easter Road slope. Works well by O'Neill, that's what he's better at. And Keith Wright is certainly onside. It's Wright taking on Winnie, teeing it up. And Pat McGinley scores for Hibernian.
The game looked lost as it reached the 90th minute, but Hibs still had the danger of Robertson to contend with.
And it's deflected for the corner kick. The pressure remains on the Hibernian defence. Well, can 10-man Hearts pull off something dramatic here? Still clear, but Love gets it away eventually. And Hibs are getting players forward now. That's a minute of stoppage time play. As Nelson plays a high one forward, McPherson's still up there. Little stumble there by John Cahoon, he's showing persistence. He's so Hearts battling right to the end, and some nerves starting to show among the Hibs players. Again, everyone's pushed forward. Well, when Robertson's inside the penalty area against Hibernian, anything's likely to happen. There's Robertson getting a little touch. Robertson trying to get in the shot! Oh, he's done it! It's unbelievable from John Robertson! He's done it again, and he's set a new record. That's his 23rd goal against Hibernian. And Robertson, 184 league goals. He overtakes that other Hearts great Willie Bald in the most dramatic circumstance here at Easter Road. Well, he's punished Hibs down through the years. He got in the little touch there with his head. The ball broke back to him. There didn't seem to be any way through, but then he found the opening. A tremendous goal by John Robertson.
A happy moment for me was the last minute goal against Hibs at Easter Road, because that meant I'd beaten Willie Bald's record, who was my dad's all-time hero. You know, he loved calling Bald and Lotto, but Bald was his top man, he was his number one, and to beat them in such an important goal, and know my big brother George was sitting there with his green and white scarf on, would be a wee bit annoyed. Made it a sweet moment.
It's spirited performances like that which have made John such a threat to Hibs since his Hearts career began 17 years ago.
John's sitting like at the Indian sign over Hibs, and whenever he goes in the park, I mean, you can see the Hibs fans just sort of turning away and let's go. Robbo's in the park, he's going to score the winning goal. And it's a wonderful feeling when you've got that against a certain team. You know you're going to play well, or you know you're going to score a certain amount of goals.
Steve Fulton with this free kick.
John Miller's a big threat. Very good near.
Stephen Tweed did well.
Poor clearance attempt by O'Neill. Lock.
Penalty kick's given. Called by Millen.
Kenny Clark had no doubt, and John Robertson now has the chance.
to continue his 100% record on the spot this season. He scored twice in two attempts, total of six for the season. And this would be his 24th Derby goal, and that is a record. He already holds the record with 23. So Robertson against Leighton, international teammates. Here comes Robertson. No answer to that. The power was too much for Leighton.
It does give us a boost to know that he can score so many goals against them, and I think to a certain extent they must feel that when he's on the bench they're a wee bit at ease, because I don't think many of their supporters will like him, because I mean the goals that he scored against them over the years has been phenomenal.
I think he definitely worries sides when he plays against them, and Hibs I don't think are any different. I think they know that his record is absolutely brilliant against them about scoring goals, because he knows that he's going to be in there getting chances, and I think Hibs more than any other team because of the record he has against them.
Even if John was perhaps going through a dip in form, when it comes to a match like Hibs, he's going to be almost first on the team sheet because of that effect. When other teams see the name on the team sheet, they know they've got a game ahead.
Well, I can remember his first goal here when he came back for Newcastle was against it. He came off the bench and we won 2-1.
Right to the far post, up goes Hutchin! The Hearts deadly from these positions around the box, with Ian Ferguson the main threat. Bannon deadly with these swerving free kicks. 5-0. Bannon leaves it. There's Ferguson. Now Bannon! There's Collins winning it back for Hibs. Well, that's good play from Collins. Running into that ruck of players in maroon and losing possession eventually. There's Ferguson putting out McKinley on the left. Robertson calls for the ball in the middle, up he goes! There's Robertson!
He scored that day, but the only thing I can really mind about that day was he had the worst haircut I've ever seen. I think it was a crew cut. He scored against Hibs. It's brilliant, eh?
Robertson!
On the edge of the penalty area as Levine plays it through. Miller getting the touch to it. Robertson's in there. Robertson doing well. And the deflection, it's a goal for Hearts! Oh, what a disaster for Hibs. John Robertson playing the ball into the middle. Oh, what a record this little man has of causing trouble for Hibs. And they got him quite disconsolate. Clock and John Robertson cutting into the penalty area, flipping forward and deflected into the net.
The lifeblood of every club is the fans, and at Tynecastle the supporters are its heart. Naturally, John is a hero to many, but he's keenly aware of the contribution of the rest of the team.
I think goal scorers are lucky in that respect, that if you can manage to get a reasonable haul of goals every season, you obviously be. It's easier to become a fan's favourite, no doubt about that. There's times when you see the midfield boys who put in a power of work, defenders who put in a power of work, don't get anywhere near the amount of praise that they should get. Whereas a striker can have a terrible game and grab a winning goal late on and instantly become the fan's hero and become the fan's favourite. It is a lot easier that way, but
you know, I hope it's not just my goals, but my general all-round play and enthusiasm that's helped win over the Hearts fans. And if they've enjoyed my career half as much as I have, then it's certainly all been worthwhile as far as I'm concerned.
John Robertson, for me, is the best player I've seen with Hearts. I mean, the goals he scored, his track record against Hibs in the derby, I always had my wager on John Robertson to score the first goal against Hibs, whether it be at Tynecastle or Easter Road. My wager was always on Robertson for the first goal, because he was the man to do it.
Hogg getting up well. There's Robertson! Typical finishing from Robertson. Hearts are ahead. 4 minutes.
Oh, he's got to be up there in a great, in any of the Hearts great teams, like, you know, like, say the 50s was a bit for my time. I never seen Colin Bold and Wardhaugh, but certainly since then, he's by far the best centre forward I've ever had since the 50s, like, no doubt about it.
When the players do realise that Robertson's playing is a headache for the manager of the opposition team to say, right, how are we going to cope with Robertson? Because he's always there to get out and score the goal. Yeah, I would fear John Robertson in any team sheet.
But it's almost as worth a goalie a start for Hearts against the Hibs. They do tend to panic when Robertson's playing for some reason. And man marking, they tend to put two men on Robertson, which frees it for all the other players, you know. So we're in a no-win situation when he's mentioned, I'm afraid to say.
Slick one, Dowd and Miller. Hibs have it again though. It's Dowd. Jackson. Again, Bickford's deep in his own half, gets it away. Showing good pace again. The chance is on for Robertson, he must score! Another milestone in the marvellous career of this little man. It's his 25th goal against Hibernian. It's his 250th goal for Hearts. He's absolutely delighted.
We can never write you Robbo off. He's always dangerous about the box. And he's popped up again. He's broken Hearts again.
Robertson trying to get in the shot. Oh, he's done it. It's unbelievable from John Robertson.
And the Robertson dynasty may continue through his three sons, Mark, Liam and Scott. As for the opposition, his nephew Robbie can play a bit too. Robbie and Mark are not surprising, but when it comes to choosing their favourite players, Liam has his own ideas.
My Uncle John, my dad, and I like the new signing, Adam.
John's careful not to push the boys into a football here. Instead, he suggests targets they can aim for.
He just tells us what to do and we keep on practicing and practicing. Like, when I was told me to try and get 10 keepy uppies, but I couldn't, and now I've got 46 as my record. And last night he told us, me and Rob, my cousin, Robbie here, told us to try and get 20 with left foot and right foot, and today I've done it twice, and Robbie done it once last night and once today, and my wee brother had to do 10 left foot, right foot, and he's still not done it yet.
I've got 9 and 10.
Youngest son Scott looks as though he may need an aide to advise him on his future career.
Do you want to play goalie? Defender?
No matter how hectic his football life becomes, John has free time to his wife Tracy and his family.
When you come off the golf course, that is, he likes his golf and his football, but the family as well. He's not one for going out, pubs, clubs and that. Not very often. He has his moments. Big Davies, he's the one that he disappears with. But I would say generally, yeah, family orientated. But my dad was totally into the football, and the majority of the family are football. So something I was brought up in. I like the football. I think it'd be difficult if you were a footballer's wife that hated football. Then you've got a problem. But the boys, you know, I encourage it. They're the oldest one, Mac, he's more all round football, golf. He likes both. We don't want to push any of them into football. I'd rather they just took their own time, seen what they'd done themselves.
However, football is never far away. Together, John and Tracy built a trophy room to John's long and distinguished football career.
Well, here we are in the garage, so to speak, which my wife and I have transformed into a so-called trophy room, as most Hearts fans will give me stick, or other fans will give me stick, because I've not actually won anything. But you can see I've managed to get most of my international strips. The very first one I played for Scotland here was the centenary match, which was quite a big one, and I've swapped a few in the way. I was ordered by Gary Locke here to swap this one with him along. A couple of favourites, obviously being a boyhood hero of mine, Ken Dalglish. Bought this at an auction for Alston's testimonial. So to have obviously the king is very important to me. It's a great one to have. These probably mean more to me than anything. It's my first ever pair of, which I think I wore at the age of about 4 to 6. They probably fit me now because I'm only a size 5, 5.5, but my mum kept a hold of these and passed them on to my brothers to pass on to me. So obviously a great sentimental value here, and it's something that of all the things I would give away to people are the only things I would keep myself. And what we have here is something I've kept throughout all the years, is different programmes and letters I actually received from clubs I was on trial with as a youngster to the Arsenal. Making arrangements to come down, the different letters, Blackpool, spent a week down there, Celtic, Leeds United, and Leicester, etc., all the way through. We'd send things, Man City as well. And these are all the arrangements, different bits, Nottingham Forest, stuff, Brian Clough, obviously, keeping an eye on young players. And as a youngster, obviously, you're delighted to receive these because it means you're getting there, obviously. Again, West Brom, but Mr. Robert Jenks, Bobby Jenks, who's now the community officer at Tynecastle of all places. This here is a very important thing as far as I'm concerned. In football, you've got to have certain mottos. And to me, this is one of the biggest I've always based my game on. And it was sent to me by Ken Barnes. And it basically says, what's there, best of luck. And may the ball roll kindly for you, which is what I've always based my football on. If you get a lucky bounce and the ball goes for you, you'll score a goal. If you get a bad bounce, you obviously miss it, or you could be injured or anything like that. So to me, this was all what my football philosophy is based on, and it emphasises the luck that you actually do need to do well in professional football. Well, we have other mementos and trophies that I've actually won. The medals that I have won, so to speak, I've lost two Scottish Cup final runners-up. That's a reserve cup winners medal, and a Coca-Cola Cup runners up again. It's been nice to get to final. Obviously, I prefer them to have been winners medals, but that's the way it's been for me so far. Hopefully, we can change that. These here, a bit different. I was lucky enough to be honoured by the council at the City Chambers. Eric Milligan, the Lord Provost, a big Hearts man. The biggest honour he can bestow on anybody is to present them with the cufflinks of the city. I was really touched that he had a little reception for me and presented me with these. As I say, they're only given to Lord and Lady Provost to wear, so it's a very big honour. It may not mean a lot to other people, but obviously being an Edinburgh lad, it really does mean a lot to me, and I'll treasure these, obviously, for all time.
I presented them to John Robertson because John Robertson's feat and the number of goals that he has scored for Hearts is a remarkable number of goals. That allows the Hearts supporters of today to celebrate John Robertson. I actually think the goals that John has scored entitles Hearts supporters and others to come to the view that he has actually been the greatest goal scorer ever in the Hearts history. John's got an uncanny ability to read the game. When the ball ricochets in the goal mouth, it always seems to ricochet in John Robertson's direction. And people often say, oh, an awful lot of goals, he's just rolled them into the net because he's been lucky to be at the right spot at the right time. But in truth, of course, it's because he's a very intelligent player, it's because he follows the game, and he knows where the ball is likely to land, and that shows that he is a lot more than just a good striker of the ball. He's a good reader of the game.
At the start of season 1996-97, the one record which John had been striving for, Jimmy Wardhaugh's, was now becoming a real possibility. However, the Hearts team were hungry for silverware, and that too seemed possible when they reached the quarter-final of the Coca-Cola Cup to take on Celtic.
And Hoydonk. Salvatore! Wasn't far away. That's good play from McNamara. Van Hooijdonk, difficult angle, but he very nearly... Andy Thorne takes the free kick. Yes, it is Andy Thorne of Wimbledon playing for Hearts tonight. Who just joined us. Chance for Robertson, almost a second bite at it. Their quality in this quarter final. With Van Hooijdonk. Naismith. Gary Mackay for 10 man Hearts. Cameron! Manus takes.
Despite being reduced to 10 men after Stefano Salvatore was ordered off, Hearts had survived for 90 minutes. In the interval time, Hearts fans were willing John on to help his team to qualify in his own unique way.
Well, Celtic, when the draw was made, this was a tricky tie for them, make no mistake about it. Away in Edinburgh, all the fashion of Tynecastle. Robertson, he scored!
Salvatore had the win!
Goal here, in heroic circumstances.
That brilliant strike with only 10 minutes to go ensured a place in the semis, where Hearts overcame Dundee by 3-1. It meant that Hearts would meet league champions Rangers in the final. The game would show that despite being 2 behind in the early stages, Hearts' fighting spirit would ensure that they would not lie down.
There's a good back here, and here's Mackay. Great ball in, Pye wandering square. Corner kick's given. Real opportunity there for Hearts. Great goal by Fulton! The Cup final has come alive!
The way we knew was playing the wing. We knew just to get it out of him, and the way the game was going, especially when we scored the second goal, we felt as if we could do it. No, because I'm sure a lot of people, maybe there's a wee doubt in our own minds, like when it went to 2-0, like, we're not going to get it back, especially the way the Scottish Cup final had went.
Well, I thought when the goal went in, we were definitely the better side and we were going to go on to win, but we Robbo's never far away, and some say we should have got a foul, actually, just before Gascoigne scored, and it was on we Robbo. But the feeling when we Robbo scored from across was absolutely brilliant, sheer elation.
Well intercepted by Richie.
Despite that, Rangers scored 2 late goals to Paul Gascoigne. Again, Hearts had tasted disappointment.
I must admit, at 2-2, I thought we had a real chance of winning the trophy. And the 5 minutes after that as well, We were well on top. We had Rangers on the back foot, but then Paul, you know, that's why Rangers paid $4.3 million or something for him. He showed 2-3 minutes of sheer magic, 2 fabulous goals, and recommend again. But when you consider we lost 5-1 in the previous final, to go back and to go 2-0 down quite early and fight back and give as good as we got over the piece, you've just got to keep going. You just keep knocking at the door, because sooner or later it's going to open up.
November one was the worst, because we came back in the second half. I mean, John scored the equaliser, we all thought that was it. We had earned our right to this cup till Paul Gascoigne done it to us again. That was heartbreaking. And then you face each other after the game, the wives feel as bad as the players, and you all try to put a brave face on it for each other, and it's horrendous. And then you put a brave face on it for the supporters, and they're always absolutely brilliant anyway, the Heart support, they've been great. And we thought that was his last chance at, you know, a cup medal, because that's the one thing that he hasn't got that he would truly love to get. That's his ambition now.
The Coca-Cola Cup final disappointments had made John even more determined to break the league scoring record, not only for himself, but for the legions of loyal Heart supporters.
I pride myself on the consistency. I've not done 14, 15, 16 goals a season over the last 6 or 7 years. I had a good run just around about Christmas, as I said, 9, 10 goals in 7 or 8 games, which obviously boosts the tally up. But I don't know, I just, you know, put the ball in the net, went away. Perhaps the fact that as a kid when I went to the club, the contract was up again and I needed to try and find a new one. So they always say that I do well in the last year of my contract, and there might be a bit of truth in that.
So having a bit of a go at the moment. That's a good ball! Yes! John Robertson!
John reached yet another milestone when he scored his 200th league goal against Dunfermline on Boxing Day. The New Year derby was a crucial one for Hearts. Hibs had a new manager in the form of Jim Duffy and were clearly optimistic about their new regime.
We knew going into that game that Hibs would be fired up. They were fired up. The crowd got the change at management level they'd been looking for, so they were going to get right behind them. The Hibs players would then feel the benefit of the crowd getting behind them. The fact that they were kicking downhill in the first half, we knew they would come at us, and I thought Hibs played very, very well for 20 minutes.
To be fair, Jim Jeffries must take most of the credit here, because he got us down there, he got us down a wee bit earlier than normal, got the team settled down and said, look, you know, Hibs fans, if Jim Duffy had just been appointed the manager, and he felt if Jockey Scott had still been in charge, that we could have won the game quite comfortably. But he felt with Jim Duffy being there that the Hibs fans were going to be up for it. It's a new manager, we're going to give him a big reception. New year, it's a new start for them type thing. And he felt that Hibs were going to be really up for it. And he was demanding extra concentration, extra work rate, extra everything for this game, because he knew how a victory.
John popped up at the right time. And, you know, that's what he's been good at against Hibs over the past. And great record against them. He stuck one away, and from there, Hearts completely took over.
John was able to score what was a typical Robertson goal just about 10-15 minutes before the interval to really put Hibs into serious problems. And as everyone knows, we went on to win that game 4-0. It was a most important goal and a great way to start the year. And well, as we know, Hibs just scraped through that's the end of that season, and I rather think that game probably helped them to get into the position that they eventually found themselves in.
In January, John was within one goal of equaling Wardhaugh's record, but at that crucial time, he suffered an injury which threatened to thwart his goal. An added pressure, with only three games to go, was that John's contract was due for renewal at the end of the season. Time was rapidly running out.
I picked up a groin injury originally and I missed two or three matches, came back for one and aggravated it again, and missed another two or three games. And by that time, you know, suddenly with having 11 league games to beat the record, I only had four on five. And then I picked up a niggling knee injury that required surgery, and all of a sudden it was down to the last four games. And it was really, really in that time because the fans were willing to want to do it. They wanted it done before the end of the season. The season was not petering out because we were still chasing a European slot with Dundee United, but they wanted it done, and the games were running out thick and fast. And I must admit, I wasn't the easiest person to live with at that time.
Here's Cameron. Robertson making a run inside him. That's a good pass. Here's Robertson. First touch let him down. Back with an excellent chance by top level standards, and one which John Robertson would expect to do much better with.
Because the harder I was trying, the worse it gets. And although, as I mentioned earlier, there's runs in the league where you score goals and can't miss, there's also the droughts that four, five, six games. That was exactly what was in at that moment in time. I didn't think I was going to get there.
After weeks of waiting, the opportunity finally came against Dunfermline in the third last game of the season.
He was nervous, thought he's going to get a new contract with the Hearts, so his chance of beating the record was slipping away. He was a bit difficult to live with, I would say.
Well, it was a great header back for Jim Hamilton, and Kevin Thomas actually got the first header that had a swing in my boot, and it just clipped off my boot. And to be fair, the ball hit me rather than me hitting the ball, to be perfectly truthful, but I knew I had the touch and I wasn't hanging about to dispute it.
It was the first time I managed to pull off a surprise party that he thought it would be the following week, but he didn't expect it that night. He came round the corner with Neil pointing and Big Davey and thought it was my neighbour that was having the party, with a 17-foot banner across the front of the house for him that John's friend had done, in the red carpet, and Simple the Bass playing in the background, and Gary Mackay's dad doing a wee speech to him, and as many of the old Hearts team as we could get that could manage were there.
John equaled Jimmy Wardhaugh's record of 206 goals against Dunfermline, but drew a blank the next week against Dundee United. His final chance came against Rangers in the last match of the season. And in recognition of the record, a presentation was made to John before the game.
It meant a lot. There was three presentations, and obviously the first one came from my family and Tracy's family. They decided that to mark the equaling the record that they were going to present me with a beautiful crystal ball that my father-in-law got made for me. I was very touched for that because, you know, sometimes you take your family for granted and you think, you know, they're just watching the games, but they were really chuffed, so to speak, with my achievement as well. And then obviously I got a beautiful vase from the club to mark it because they were willing one. I think it was dusty by the time I got it. They'd had it for a few weeks, but I was delighted, you know, that was there. And the fact that on a day that Rangers, you know, they saw it fitting to give a reward as well, which shows you that other people notice things that go on. I was really touched the fact that Rangers took time out to honour me as well. And as I say, it was a great start to the game, and that really sort of got me going with the hope that I could go out against Rangers and try and get the final goal to break the record. And obviously my chances were boosted when Walter told me that half his team were still recovering from the hangover, so I thought this might be the day.
Petrie's letting in John Robertson, this is a chance, that looks like a penalty, it is!
I knew the moment everybody was waiting on, the ball in the spot, and I decided myself that I was just going to hammer it down the middle. But then I heard Paul Gascoigne and Ninja Rant shouting to Bolly just to stand still. So that kind of blew that route out, so I just decided to head down and hit it into the corner. I knew what it meant, everybody knew what it meant. It was just the relief first, and then the satisfaction sort of came in as I was going. Yeah, great, that's it over and done with.
It was brought to everybody concerned with the club. I mean, Jimmy Wardhaugh was a legend here, and it just shows you how much a legend Robbo is now that he's broke the record. I mean, I don't think there'll be any player who'll equal his record.
Like, I was elated for him. He's friends with somebody for a number of years, and you can feel the pressure getting to them. And once they get over that barrier, they're just delighted. They did happen to buy me a bottle of champagne later on.
If John's goal was memorable as the record breaker, his second will be long remembered for proving his sheer football ability and style.
John Robertson again, persistence, chance to run at Jörgen Björklund. He's inside of Robertson. This is a chance for a goal. Robertson! A great goal by John Robertson! He's not only broke the record, he smashed it!
Typical strikers, you've not scored for a couple of games, you get a goal and then all of a sudden you can't miss. And you know, I went in a wee bit of amazing and put the ball away, which I don't think anybody's ever seen John Robertson run so far with the ball. Better strikers, I thought.